Welcome at the presentation about scene classification for the SNOW project. My name is Fieke Hillerström, and in this presentation I will explain the work I did together with Maaike de Boer about scene classifications based on object detections. I will explain how we add knowledge to our system and how it improved our predictions about which scene the robot will be in. If you look at the whole system that the spot robot will operate in, you can detect several steps as Joris explained in his overview presentation. Spot will walk in the villa and he will search for victims to rescue. In order to be able to reason and navigate in the villa and reason about what it's to expect, he needs to know in which scene or which room it is. Therefore, we designed a model which can do scene classification based on detected objects and knowledge available. So if you look at this overview picture, we can determine our work in this location, the place where it recognized objects and indicates itself in the hall. The challenge we address in this presentation is for Spot to predict in which room it is. Because it's impossible to retrain all the models with a lot of data every time, because possibly you don't have a lot of data available about the new situation you will go into, we assume that there are only a few training examples available for every scene type that we want to detect. For detecting the scene type, we make use of object detections. For example, if you look at the room Spot is looking at now, you can detect a lot of object types. There are objects that are recognized in the image, but there are also false positives, as you can see in the ceiling. Not all the objects detected are correct, and there is some noise available in the data. Using these detected objects and a few training examples, we will predict which type of room it is. So our challenge is to learn to predict scene types based on a few training samples and available knowledge about those rooms, which can help you to determine in which room you are. We translated this goal that we have into research in which we compare different approaches. In our research, we have different scene types available. For example, the living room, as we saw before, but also a home office, as is in this picture. In these scenes, we detect the objects available. As you can see here, we have detected some objects, but the objects that can appear in the different type of rooms can be the same. So in the living room and in the home office, you can detect a chair or a table, that kind of things. And still you want to predict their difference. What we want to research is whether adding knowledge about the type of rooms that you can encounter will help with our predictions. So as you can see here, we will look at the knowledge that you can give. For example, a living room can contain a lamp and a vase, or a home office can contain a book or a decoration, that kind of things. And if we add this type of knowledge, we want to look if our predictions about the type of rooms will improve above only using the data itself. But where do we get this knowledge from that we are using? You don't want to write the knowledge that you will use every time you encounter a new room by hand or by yourself. That is explained in this slide. We will use common knowledge based on experience and on common knowledge available. So we have a large knowledge tree available in our internet or in our internal knowledge of the spot. And based on the question you will ask him, for example, in which room am I, it will look at the whole knowledge available and extract the parts that are needed for room classification. So the whole tree will look like a bit larger, and then it selects the subsection that is needed for our predictions to make. Now, a detailed explanation about how this generation of the knowledge graph and things work will be available in one of the other snow videos because it's linked to another part of the spot's internal workings. And that's if you go back to the same system as before, you can see where this will be. Over here in this video about WordNet, ConceptNet and how they are combined to extend the knowledge with the relevant concepts needed to fulfill the task asked. Which room am I in the villa? And then I will continue with an explanation of our research and I'll explain which methods we compared. So we have rooms available with all the detections. And then you can just, based on this type of detections, train a neural network to predict in which scene you are. But we compared this approach with a neural network to the use of a graph network. And why did we use want to look into a graph network? Because graph networks can learn with relations, but it's also possible to extend the graph network with new concepts or new things after you have trained it. And I will explain later on why this is the case. We not only compare those two types of networks, we also compare the influence of adding knowledge to those networks. If we use our knowledge about what we can expect in a room, will the predictions improve or not? And now I will give a short introduction into the technologies that we have used. I will start with a neural network, which takes a vector as an input. So for example, you can see a vector over here, which we put at the input, a 0, 1, 1, and it will be used by the network to make a prediction at the output. So at the output layer, you make a prediction at the input data. This prediction is made by using weights that are placed on the vectors and to construct hidden layers. So in the hidden layer, you will get an abstract representation of your input data. And this abstract representation can then be used for another representation and then be used in the outputs to make predictions about your data. The way that you construct these hidden layers, so that you construct these representations, that's learned based on the data that you have available. So you want to learn the best way to represent your data based on the training data that you have at the input with the label about what you need to predict at the output. And because you learn the weights that are placed over here, so in the network, the size of your network is fixed because you kind of learn a matrix in which you need to multiply to get your output. And if you add another value to your input, you will not be able to use this in the network because you did not learn which weight you have to use to convert it into a prediction. So you have the size of your input and output and hidden layers is fixed after you have trained it. And neural networks are really old already, but recently with the new computational power available, they are used a lot, especially in the field of imaging, to make predictions about the data, and they're really powerful. As you see, the input layer and the output layer, I want just to emphasize it another time, it's fixed in the size, you cannot change these values. And then if we look at graph networks, that's a recent new technique used in the field of artificial intelligence and deep learning, which has a kind of another way of thinking. Instead of representing your data just as a vector, as a matrix or tabular data, you use a graph to represent your data. In this graph, a node represents an entity, so something you can observe in the world. And nodes are connected via edges towards each other. And those edges tell something about the relation between the nodes. For example, which things are close to each other or which things are related, that kind of things. And you could have a global variable that tells something about the graph as a whole. So about the whole system you're representing and not only one observed entity. If we take a look at this example, then you can see nodes and edges and a global variable. Now, all the nodes, they have a feature vector, an attribute vector telling something about the node. Now, the edges that are in the graph could have attributes. It's not needed, but you could encode some information about your graph. For example, what is the distance between two entities or two nodes? That kind of things you can encode in an edge attribute. And you could have a global attribute, which represents something about the whole graph, but it's not needed. It depends on the type of problem which you want to solve. Now, in our case, if we look at the scene prediction, we have nodes with a vector, an attribute vector added, and we have a global variable which represents the scene type that we want to encode. And the nodes have a vector representing the object types. We do not have edge attributes because we want to start with a simple problem, and we leave this out for the first experiment. Now, if you then are going to learn with this graph network, then you do several iterations to come to a prediction. First, you will look as a node to all your neighbors and update your feature vector, not only based on your own feature, but you will look at your neighbors, look, oh, what is his feature, what is his attribute, and then combine this and make an update of your own attribute. So you will, during the prediction, you will not only the information of a single node is used, but first they iterate with each other to come to a more common prediction. Then in the next step, the global variable will update its attribute based on all the nodes that are in the system. So it looks at the whole vector space that is available at all the vectors, and it will look at itself, and then it will make an update of its own attribute vector. And this will repeat it a few times so that in the end, the information that's captured in the whole graph is taken into account. And the neighbors are taken into account because the nodes update dependent on which neighbors it has. And then the overall information is taken into account by the global attribute, which predicts which scene it will be. Now I will explain further how we set up our experiments. How did we come from the image with the text objects, as you can see over here, to a graph network or a neural network that can be used for training? If you look at the image with the detected objects, then we construct a graph network by adding the detected objects in the graph as a node. Every detected object will be added once, so if you have multiple faces in your room, then there will only be one node representing the face. It tells that there has been seen one or more faces in the image. This graph network will be used for training, and in the graph, all the objects are connected to each other, and there will be a global attribute which will be used for predicting the scene type. Now, in the neural network, you have the same room with detections, but instead of a graph, a vector will be constructed in which there's an input, as you can see over here, and those objects are counted whether they're available in the graph or not. So have you seen a chair, there will be a one. Have you not seen a chair, there will be a zero. This will result in one vector representing the scene, which will be used as the input for training. And this is the case in which we do not add knowledge to our system. And if we add knowledge to our system, it will look a little bit different. And that's what you can see over here. We first look at the graph network. If we add knowledge to the system, we will not only have the objects that are in the room in the system, as you can see over here, But you will also have two nodes representing the knowledge available. The knowledge, I've made an example of the knowledge that could be present in your system. It will be combined with the detected objects to come to one graph. And then in this picture, I highlighted how we came to the knowledge. So we looked, oh, a vase. In our knowledge, it says it could be a living room. So then we will add an edge from the vase to the living room. And if we look at decoration, or we observe decoration, then we should add an edge from decoration to home office and add the home office as a node to our graph, and an edge from the decoration to the living room, because this is what your knowledge is telling that's available in your that's an indicator for being that scene. So we add those indicators by adding an edge to our graph. Now I want to come back to the fact that graph networks are more flexible than neural networks. In a graph network, you can detect, if you have a new detected type of object, for example, you have trained your network to now be able to detect telephones in the image, then if you have detected a telephone, you can add a new node to the graph and connect it to the other nodes and use it in your predictions. But in a neural network, you do not have room available in your represented vector space to be able to represent the telephone, and you cannot add the extra detected object, and you cannot take it into account into your predictions. And this way makes graph networks more flexible as your knowledge grows during operation and new information is added to the system. If we now look at how we represented the data in the graph network, then we choose to use a one-hot encoding to represent the object types in the nodes and a vector of 4 length to represent the global scene type. And the length of 4 is chosen because we have 4 different scene types to detect. You could change the one-hot encoded vector to use a kind of vector representing the type of object or type of scene in your graph, and based on, for example, word embedding, so that you have more context in your graph. But we choose to keep it simple and just use a one-hot encoded vector in our case. Then for the neural network, we set up a vector. If we add the knowledge, we still have the vector with our detected objects and the zeros and the ones. And then in the end, we add the scene types with an indicator. If we have seen objects that indicate that it could be a living room, which is also an extraction from our knowledge, then we add a one. If we did not have seen objects that would indicate a living room, then we will add a zero. And in that way, we construct one large vector used at the input for the neural network. Then in the end, there was one last improvement that we made. Instead of only encoding if there was an object seen or not, we add the occurrence of the objects in the room. So if we add, if we have seen multiple chairs, for example, then the indicator for chair would be not only a zero, but the number of times you have seen the chair. So therefore the n, it indicates how many times you have seen the chair. And also for the indicators of the knowledge, for example here, you would count how many times you have seen an indicator for that scene type. So if there are 3 objects found that would say, ma, probably it's a dorm room, then you will add a 3 over there. And if there are only 2 objects found saying, oh, it would be a living room, then there will be a 2. So in that case, you add some prior knowledge about which type of scene it will be, probably be, because you will set a kind of prior on your knowledge and use this in your predictions. Now I will tell something about the data set that we have used for the experiments. We used a data set, the ADA data set, containing images about scenes. And on the different type of scenes, and we selected 4 type of rooms. the dorm room, the living room, the office, and the home office to classify them based on the object detections. Now, to represent the case in which you do not have a lot of examples about the places that you are going into, we selected only 24 images per scene type to use for training. Now, on these images, we applied the object detector and we set a threshold at the detection rate of 0.1 to mimic the fact that your object detector could be a bit noisy, because maybe you want to have specific objects really characterizing that type of room, but that are not that easy to train. So we wanted to mimic that kind of thing, that you trained an object detector on the fly on some images of the internet, and that your performance is not that high, so you will have a lot of detections. And then we come up an average object per image count of 42. And we used 78 test set examples to make our evaluation to look if our system performs well or not. Now, if we then look at the prediction accuracy for the different type of scenes, we have run the experiments 5 times to measure the stability of our training process and our predictions. And we listed the mean accuracy and the standard deviation in the table below. And we added a baseline in which we only used the knowledge as a rule, so saying we have seen we counted the number of objects indicating for different knowledge for a different scene type, and then the highest number would be the scene that we were predicting. And if you compare those mean accuracies that you can see over here, I will draw a line, then what you conclude is that the graph network outperforms the neural network if the knowledge is added. So if we have knowledge added to a graph network, it will be better than our neural network just trained on the object detections itself. And the graph network benefits more from adding knowledge than the neural network. So the knowledge is better used by the graph network than the neural network. That brings us to the conclusions for now, that graph networks could benefit from adding knowledge when data is noisy or when there are little training examples, and neural networks cannot, or they seem at least less suited to add knowledge. And we're still doing more experiments to validate it on different kinds of use cases and see, we'll try to get more insight in why it would benefit. What can we learn from this? Can we explain why we got to these observations, that kind of thing? So we hope to extend these conclusions with new insights later on. I hope you enjoyed the presentation and you get some insight in the work we're doing about adding knowledge to data and machine learning predictions and how we use it for scene detections. If you have questions later on, you can always contact us by the email that we added in the description below. You can see it later. And feel free to contact us. And enjoy watching the other presentations. Thank you.